They're on a collision course to play the LA Lakers in a play-in tournament in a 9-10 game. And the Warriors are now putting themselves in a position to where they got to win the 9-10 game and then the 7-8 game to just make the playoffs as an 8 seed.
So I'm not mad at all at the effort yesterday. They just didn't have enough firepower. I loved what JK, you know, just the way he was playing yesterday. You know, everybody losing their minds about Klay Thompson over the year. Like, I'll say this about Klay. He suited up. He's always suiting up. And there is something to be said for that. There is. There were times I thought Wiggins was playing aggressive, especially early on. It felt like they were locked in. It was a rock fight for the first half in terms of both teams,
right.
You know, missing shots. I thought the defense was excellent from the Warriors at times. TJD had a rougher night because I thought that those two bigs are just, they're outstanding.
Yeah,
I couldn't believe how good they were.
Daniel Gafford, a sneaky move by the Mavericks at the deadline to trade. To get him out of Washington.
He's excellent.
7 block shots last night, Shasky. The Mavericks overall blocked 13 shots. And Derek Lively, the second guy,
is
out of Duke.
Very nice.
Oh, he's nice. 12-8 last night. He had a couple block shots.
A fluid mover, too, yep. up and down the floor. Like, he doesn't run like a 7-footer. You know right. what I mean? He's very nice. And then Kyrie and Luka, we'll get to them. But I got to just keep it 100. Like, and I'm just me. And I don't know how many people agree with me. But, like, you know, Draymond does so many great things on the floor. And then right before the game starts, I find out, oh, he's going to sit out with the back. Now, he's probably hurt. Probably really does have a back thing. It's just, it's almost predictable, though. When I look up, and it's like, okay, Steph's not playing. And then, boom, Draymond's out. And I'm just like, I don't know. I'm not saying that he's methodically sitting these games out. I'm not going that far. But what I am saying is just like, dude, we need you in these games. Like, right. These are the games that I need one of my Hall of Famers to step up when the chips are up against it, you know, and when we're going all in. This is a team that you're vying for a plus one. It's not the end of the world game.
Right.
But it's like, really? I was let down. Now, I know he's probably hurt. Maybe I sound absurd. But I was like, really, dude? And then you're jumping up and down and you're helping guys off the floor. I was just like, you couldn't play in this game? Like, I don't know, man. I thought that one left a bitter taste in my mouth.
Look, I'm not going to question players whether or not they're hurt or they want to sit out because a particular player is not playing or whatnot. It came up on the injury report Monday. Obviously, game time decision got scratched yesterday. Backs are tricky. I get it. I know a lot of people are disappointed by him not playing, especially in a game like that. You had 3 matchups left with the Mavericks. You got to win these games. You have to win these games.
Exactly.
It's tough. Now, you hope he bounces back Saturday night against the LA Lakers, the team they haven't beaten in LA.
Yes.
Since the season opener in 2021-22, and they're coming off a big loss against the Sacramento Kings. They got swept in the season series.
Lakers stink!
Did you hear Spadoni this morning?
Oh, he's not happy. Spadoni. But he'll be happy, you know. If they beat the Warriors on Saturday, he'll be happy on Monday. He'll be back.
Anthony Davis has lost how many in a row? To Sabonis?
10 straight games. 10 straight games.
Shocking. The other thing about like watching that game, and I tease a little at times, but I am sincere in this. Like, and we talk about Dame Lillard, and I always feel like, and I'm not this big Kyrie fan. Right. I'm not one of these player stands that, oh my God, this guy's one of the greatest ever. But when you watch Kyrie last night, and I hear Fitz talk about this, he hasn't played 17 straight games in 7 years. You do forget. No, I'm serious.
Yeah, no,
forget how great he is. He's unbelievable. And look, I know he's not the greatest defender, but in terms of setting up teammates around the rim, finishing around the rim, getting any shot he wants on the perimeter, blowing by guys, finishing over bigger dudes, the dexterity with either Kyrie, in terms of talent, he's on a short list of guards in terms of just raw talent offensively in the half court to get anything he wants for his team. He's a spectacular player.
Dude. He made some moves in that fourth quarter last night. And you're right. You forget how good he is because of all the other stuff. You know, the political stuff, which kept him off the floor of Brooklyn and kind of ruined that little culture there.
That's a good point.
Where he wasn't playing at home and you could never... It'd be him, Kyrie Hart, and KD played 16 games together. 16 games together, something like that. That's it was incredible, right? And he set up the whole Brooklyn situation with KD or whatnot, and then they trade for James Harden. But you forget how good he is with the handles. He may have some of the best handles I've ever seen in NBA history. But like no joke. Like the N1 with the left hand yesterday. He did it with the left from 10, 15 feet out and just kept the left up. And you're just like, man, Kyrie says some crazy stuff, man. He is.
Him and Aaron Rodgers are very out similar.
There. Yeah, he could be out there. But boy, he's smiling. He's got the crazy little earring in the right ear with the feather. I don't know what's going on with him. But when he gets on that court and he puts that uniform on, and this is like after Sage in the court. I don't know if he still does that where he's walking around the court with Sage.
Him and Gabe Kapler?
Yeah. I don't know what Kyrie's doing.
Those two. But I want to see a podcast with those two.
But damn, the things he could do with the basketball, man, he's still got the quickness. And he's 31 years old now, and he's had a plethora of injuries. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, but his body does look good.
He looks like he's in great shape.
Yeah, he does.
He doesn't need the usage rate is down because of Luka Doncic. So he's able to rest a little bit more. They're a very intriguing team to me when it comes to the Western Conference playoffs, if they do get to the Western Conference playoffs. This is a guy who averages, he's got a career average of 23.5 points per game. And to your point about, like, we say Dave because he's been available
He doesn't say the wacky, wild things Kyrie does.
But there's no doubt Kyrie is a top 75 talent in league history. I mean, he was the number one overall pick for a reason.
The hard part, like, when you see like Aaron Rodgers, right? I do believe on some level Aaron Rodgers is kind of underperformed for how great he is as a player.
Yep.
No, I do. I really
do.
You
think he's underperformed?
Aaron Rodgers in the playoffs specifically.
Oh, in the playoffs.
Like,
in the playoffs.
Right, I think he left a little on the table, right?
He did.
If you will, right? When I look at Kyrie, almost in a different way, because of his own stuff, he's left a little on the table.
Whether
it's the injuries, whether it's, you know, not being the greatest teammate or, you know, saying wild things and getting himself in trouble. But at the end of the day, I mean, the guy's, he's 31?
31 already. I mean, he got to the league when he was 19 years old after playing, what, 8, 9, 10 games at Duke?
Look,
remember he got hurt at Duke and he came back for the tournament?
Yeah, broke his wrist?
The injury, but he missed basically, he may have played less than 10 games at Duke University.
I think you're right.
And then became the number one overall pick.
Well, and I mean, he.
And then won Rookie of the Year.
See why.
And then became Rookie of the Year. So you forget how good he is. I thought the Warriors did a good job at throwing multiple bodies at Luka Doncic. Wiggins actually defended him very well at times here. They made Luka work. He was a high volume scorer yesterday. 18 shots to score 21 points.
Oh,
didn't drop a triple double. 9 assists. But you see the skill set here. And, you know, TJD. He got to start yesterday, obviously, because Draymond Green got scratched, and they were trying to pinpoint TJD. But he's a player, though. But you know what, though? TJD, in a lot of ways, like Jonathan Kuminga, he gets better as the game goes along. His IQ's up there, and he's a very intelligent guy, verticality, trying to contest shots. And look, it was tough for him because he's really athletic, and these are big. But you look around the league, and you're like, boy. These other bigs that these other teams have. He's 6'9". He's trying to battle with Lively and Gafford. He's thicker. But you know what? He battles, man. I got no problem with the effort by these young Warriors yesterday. I do. I have no effort. You know, GP2 came in, didn't have the impact that you wanted him to have.
Moody hit a three, broke the streak.
I thought Moody was a sleeper yesterday. He played hard yesterday. Dunk was nice. Pods
or
played hard.
Whatever that play was, baseline.
And you can see it with Brandon Podziemski real quick because I know I'm all over the place.
No, I like it. I like it.
Pods in the summer, he knows the next step for him is to hit wide open jumpers because they're going to give him the jumpers. He was 4-12. Plus, when he's going to the rim, he's going to learn that, hey, man, you can hit those layups all you want to. The Dallas Mavericks were sitting on his layup package, sitting on it. They were sending that thing to the fifth row.
You know, Podziemski, there's a couple things. Like, I think he's a really nice player. I just don't know about him ever being an all-star. And look, I'll be wrong. I'd love to be wrong up on that. I don't know about him ever being a starter. The thing that does bug me when I watch him play, and he does a lot of really good things. If I watch him take a hard couple of dribbles into the paint with nowhere to go and then having to pivot and then throw it back out, that is one thing that leads. And it's a quiet, subtle thing. It leads to a lot of late, frenetic possessions where the Warriors jack up a bad shot. Mm-hmm. And I would say it's the offense that gets initiated by Pajanski, who's a young player, where he gets into traffic, not knowing where he wants to go, and then he ends up having to throw it back out to somebody, like, hey, your turn, you create. And it's like, ah! Like, I don't want to see JK have to, you know, take two dribbles and throw something up because that's all he's got.
Right.
Or Wiggins bomb one from three, or Clay bomb one from three. And I think at times we're like, oh, bad shot by Clay, bad shot by Wiggins. Like, well, wait a minute, like, you threw the guy the ball with 4 seconds left. What are they supposed to do? Chris Paul had a play in particular that I was thinking about, you know, where it's hot potato, and then he gets the ball on the base. Like, well, he's got to put that up against the lively, the seven-footer.
Right, no doubt.
And I just think that's, he's young, man. Pajewski's really young.
And that's what I'm saying. That's what I was going to say here, followed up on you there. He's going to have to learn because he's a rookie.
Yes.
I'm like, the production you're getting from Pajewski to production you're getting from Chase Jackson-Davis, these are bonus, like Steve Kerr mentioned on with Grandy and Dibs the other day. Look, we weren't expecting this impact from these two guys. So they're ahead of schedule. It's all part of the learning process. I don't worry about the stuff. Learn, get your mistakes out the way now. Mm-hmm. Play through the mistakes. That's how young players get better. And finally, that's why Jonathan Kuminga is exploding onto the scene, because you're allowing him to play, and he scores 27 yesterday, and he was your number one option because Clay was getting shadow bottled up, and Clay just didn't have it. CP3 didn't have it. You're not going to win a game without Steph and Dre when your starting backcourt goes 7-25 and scores only 17 points.
No. Did he started on the bench in the fourth quarter, correct?
Who's that?
Kuminga.
Kuminga, if I'm not mistaken, he did.
Yeah, because by the time he checked back in, they had like 2 points, and it was like
it was bad.
5 minutes. And I'm saying, like, and it's tough because you got to sit a guy a little here and there, but like, was that the kind of night with a couple of days off, you go like 40, 45 minutes for JK? Or is that too aggressive?
Maybe.
Are those days just never coming back?
It felt like, we're watching the game in the third quarter. And I'm not going to lie to you. In the third quarter, it just felt like, all right, if the Mavericks put together a good 5-minute stretch, they're going to go away. They're going to win this game.
But they cut it to four.
They did cut it to four. They cut it to four in the third quarter. But the Mavericks in the first half, I believe they were 1-14 from the three-point line.
They were going to hit.
They were going to start hitting. And they were getting wide open looks. They kind of were sleepwalking out there, knowing that Steph and Dre were not playing. And so it just felt like a matter of time before the Mavericks would put it away. But the Warriors battled. I can't be mad at them. The veterans, look, man, when you get Chris Paul going 4-12, you get Klay Thompson going 3-13, you get Andrew Wiggins going 5-12, and really he dressing up at the end of the game there, playing hard in the fourth quarter, they're not going to win many games without Steph and Dre when your three veterans are shooting that poorly. Look, in the first half alone, Wiggins, CP3, and Klay Thompson were a combined 3-15 from the floor for 11 points. And yet you were only down 6. So I felt good at halftime. I felt good at halftime thinking, boy, if you could get one of those guys going, maybe two, boom, you'll be all right. But you know what? The Mavericks, they had a game plan for CP3. They made it work on defense. They made Clay work on defense. And they just didn't have it tonight. I can't crush Clay and CP3.
No.
It's tough for me to crush those guys when they've been playing so well. You're going to have some tough nights. You want them to pick it up there in a game like that, but you're going to have tough nights, man.
What'd you think of Wiggs?
Defensively, I saw some things. Offensively, I just want him to be more aggressive. Now, does ball pounding hurt his game? I think it does.
I would agree with
that. I think it does. What made Wiggins so good was the 0.5 basketball, moving the ball, everybody's touching it. Right now, Chris Paul, let's face it, Chris Paul does move the ball, but he's more of a ball pounder at times. He needs the ball, get the pick and roll, get TJD diving down to the rim. And also, Pajewski's a bit of a ball pounder as well. That hurts Andrew Wiggins' game. Now, Andrew Wiggins has had a lost year. There's no doubt about that. At times, you don't even notice him out there, and that's a problem. At times, he's aggressive. Before he left for personal reasons, he was being aggressive. He was playing his best basketball of the season. But you see a game like last night, and you get 19 assists, tied for the fewest all season, Jaskie. 19 assists last night for the Golden State Warriors, and only 9 threes. The ball movement, it wasn't there last night. And I thought Dallas, they have one of the worst defenses in the league. I thought if you just be patient in a half court, you're going to get quality shots. Yet the Warriors were kind of just out of sorts offensively, man. They were rushing things. They were forcing things. But ball pounding hurts a guy like Andrew Wiggins. I'm not making excuses for him. It just is what it is.
Well, I think this is where they get caught in Pandora's box. If you want to have a philosophical conversation regarding it. I see a lot of there are so many what I call Steph fans, which I don't even know if they're Warrior fans. They're just, we're all Steph fans, but you know what I'm talking about. Steph stands. And when you build an entire roster to just complement what Steph Curry does, when Steph Curry's out, that roster is not the same kind of roster that you would construct if you didn't have Steph Curry because of the unique, specific play way that he plays. And I look at it like, all right, and then factor in no Draymond Green as well, who is going to be a guy who's going to hold the ball a lot at the top of the key on a lot of offensive possessions for the 30 minutes that he's out there. Like, I just think that dramatically changes what you look like. And this is why I was like so frustrated. I didn't think they were going to come in and win that game. And I didn't think it was the end all be all.
Right.
But to me, it's to send a shot across the bow to Dallas, you know, with my my three Hall of Famers and one more coming. And the young guys, like, we're a force to be reckoned with.
You know, that Chicago Bulls loss, and there's a lot of losses this season, losing a 22-point lead against Sacramento in Sacramento. Blowing two Clipper games, one Clipper game when you're up 22. You led the entire game until Paul George hits a three over Klay Thompson at Crypto.com Arena on a Saturday afternoon. The lead that you blew against the Lakers in a double overtime game. You know, the lead you blew against OKC in an overtime game. Not fouling Chet at the end of the game and allowing him to hit a three because you blow a switch there with Wiggins and CP3. Fouling Chet like Draymond did at OKC and even nails all three free throws. There's a lot of games we're going to look back and say, damn, this is why we're in 10th place. And then you look at the last week. You lose a Saturday. You lose a San Antonio. You get blown out by San Antonio. You had to battle Monday just to beat San Antonio, and you lose to the Bulls. Now you're going to be probably locked into the 10 seed. You're going to be playing road games just to get into the playoffs. 17 left. It's going to be tough to catch Sacramento, who's four up in the loss column. Dallas is now three up in the loss column. It's going to be tough. Now it feels like they're just locked into the 9-10 seed. And now it's just a matter of who do you want to play, the Lakers or Mavericks?
Well, if I'm Adam Silver, I'm pulling a David Stern. Do you know what I mean?
You're pulling some strings to get these guys in the playoffs?
No. I don't know if you remember, but 2003, Minnesota and the Lakers were going to be the 4-5 matchup. And it was a five-game series in the first round. At least that's what it used to be.
Right.
And everybody was like, ooh, not sure we want Minnesota and the Lakers to be a five-game series because if one of those teams bows out, if the Lakers end up losing, TV, man, they're not going to be happy.
Lakers!
And they turned it to a seven-game series. Does anyone remember this when they made
the format?
Yes.
Seven-game series.
They did it in the middle of the season.
Did they really?
Yes.
I don't remember they did that in the middle of the season.
They started to realize that it was coming down the pike. And if you Google and find it, I'm sure someone will find it somewhere.
Really?
And it was a David Stern special. If I was running the league, I'd be turning this play-in just for the Lakers-Warriors into a 3- or 5-game schedule.
They have been known to change stuff just for the Lakers, too. Remember the 2-3-2 format they used to have in the NBA Finals and stuff
because
like that.
Because they didn't want the Lakers going back to Boston and Boston coming back to the Lakers because of the cross-country flights and every other
thing. And it was better not to have the home court at the beginning of that. You have three straight at home? What kind of advantage is that?
Well, no, they changed it. They changed that, the 2-3-2. They went to 2-3-2 because of the Lakers in Boston. And then they changed it back because the Heat and Spurs, and the Spurs were mad because the Heat got the last two games in the NBA Finals after being up 3-2.
The air conditioning, too. You guys remember that?
David Stern's NBA is the best. So my point being is if I am Adam Silver, I'm turning this into a 3-game bonanza.
Probably won't happen.
No, I know. I'm teasing.
Probably won't happen. But, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough to not have. I mean, what if the Lakers and Warriors beat the Mavs and Sacramento Kings and keep them out of the playoffs? We'll see about that. I mean,
you know who they need to get on the job if they want that to happen?
Scott Foster.
Scott Foster.
Well, Scott